Okay.
Now, if you look at, I am going to take one of my previous examples. If you had been in one of my previous classes, probably it is recycled. And I have gone for a few very interesting site surveys. And I always like the experience at Bokaro. So usually, you know, like you go right from the railway station in a report, like what are the nearest things, nearest rivers. In fact, this is a bridge which was there, close to the site. So we try to see, for instance, in all these railway bridges, you'll have the HFL mark. What is HFL? High flood level, high flow level. Okay. So you will immediately know what could be the highest water is going to come and get onto your site. Okay. Now in this site, this is a brownfield site. It was an extension of the old existing thermal power plant, which has been termed as a heritage power plant. Now, what happened here is the contractor over here, he had already dumped a lot of his material all over the place. Because he had dumped his material, we could not do our work. Because he dumped his material, we could not do our work. If suppose we get the contract. So this thing we noticed in the stage when, you know, like before the job was done, before we went, this was a pre-tender site visit. So immediately, you know, there was something called reservation, right? So we had a reservation that if this gentleman doesn't take his material off our battery limit, we will not be able to do the work. What is battery limit? It is the area where you are eligible to work in. Okay, certain places only you are eligible to walk, right? So it's like that. If, for instance, are you allowed to go to VIT Lake, or are you allowed to go behind that forest area TT? It is beyond your battery limit. That's how it is. Okay, in a construction site also. So for instance, see, you can see the high tension wires which are going here. These are around 250 kV lines. So I'm sorry, 25 kV lines. So when we are having these 11 or 25 kV lines inside the site, shifting this is in our scope. In the tender document, we'll ask our query, sir, such and such thing is there, whose scope of work is shifting of HT lines? If you are going to shift to HT lines, you cannot dismantle it, move it to another place. If you are going to work for 10 days, who is going to supply power at the downstream end? So you cannot do it. You need to work, you have to do a new system altogether, and this will be only scrap. So we cannot actually do it. Okay. And this gentleman was one of our business unit heads. He is standing here and he is looking in the direction of the conveyor. So immediately we take a photograph and say, with reference to that building, your conveyor belt is going to go in this direction. Okay. So these are some of the other photos. See, when you go to the site, you get a very good idea of the ground condition because of the foundation they are doing. Of course, this is a very massive foundation which is being done for a chimney. Okay, if you are seeing all the chimneys, can you imagine what is the size of the foundation? See the size of this man, see the size of this foundation, how deep it's going to be. I got another photograph also. Okay, I think I'm not sure, I had another photograph. So all the types of foundations which we have, the consultant is the same. So what type of shear key he is insisting, and in this one immediately we understood that encasing of the base plate is required. So so many things you can understand. Look at the way the foundation has been done. Look at the size of this man. There's a lot of water, we don't know how deep it is. So essentially this is all plumb concrete which is being done. So we know that we have to increase the estimate of plain cement concrete just from the site visit. So if you don't have the site visit, probably we may not have been able to take such a call. Okay. So this is the ash pond. We had some work. We had to do a stacker reclaimer on this, make a coal stockyard here. And so these are some of the photos we took. So in each of these, we had a learning to take back. Okay, that means we had to, in the sense that learning about the project. So whenever you go for a project, 10 minutes, no problem, you're better. Okay, I'm not going in too much into this particular thing. However, I'm coming to another project. This is in Daitari Mines, Orissa, or Odisha as we call it. This was in a forest area. Okay. So, what happened here is, we had to do a new conveyor belt, a long belt conveyor. Survey was done. We had to verify whether the survey was right. We cannot tell that the survey which was done by the owner was wrong after he signed the contract. We should do it before. Okay. If you, and in this particular case, we were also giving an alternate route for the conveyor belt. Okay. So when we went there, we found that there was an existing crushing plant, and this crushing and screening plant also they wanted us to take a tap off. So this is a brownfield job which we are doing here. Again, this was a brownfield job, so we had a lot of things to see, like what is the existing foundation, what type of foundation. If suppose you are going to put a very foundation very close to this column over here, can you think of any problem which you'll encounter? You need to put a foundation very close to this. Already they put a foundation pad. If you cut that foundation pad, there is a risk involved, right? So if that foundation is still there, but still you need to make a new foundation, how you are going to do it is a challenge. Okay. So these are all some things which you usually do in a site visit. Okay. So of course these are all old things. I don't know if you want to go through it, you come sometime to my cabin, I can explain what all we did here in Leshare. Okay. This was a new type of survey called LIDAR which we are doing. So once the survey is done, you see the way you can, of course this is very common, notice it's very common, your smartphone has all the GPS maps involved, right? So that is what he is actually showing, and this person was the surveyor of OMC, Odisha Mining Corporation. So you see, if you look at the jungle, you will only see trees. You cannot tell a person this is the route of the conveyor, right? So that's why we make a person stand and make them point. A nice way to bring home a site report, right? So you know where or what exactly is happening when you look at it, okay? So this is all the typical surveys. In this jungle, we are not allowed to even break a single twig. This is a benchmark. You would have heard of benchmark in survey, right? This is how the benchmark is going to be. All the data will be there. And I don't know, I think I have a photograph of the thing, of the drawing. So on that, the same number will be reproduced, okay? So this is a differential GPS. So if you're going for surveying, you may not be able to only use your handheld and do it. But of course, you'll find that your handhelds are also quite accurate. This is the LIDAR equipment. It is just like sonar, but instead of sound, it uses light, okay? We were going to make a new wagon loading system here, and that's why we have taken all these photographs. Okay, so how much water is available, how deep it is, what is the HFL? This was taken from a railway track, so a lot of information like will be immediately got when you take photographs using your, you know, like knowledge of the system. Okay, so here we knew about railways, so we knew that, you know, this would be the HFL. So things like that can be done by you. And again, you can here, you know, like the embankment is so high, so how much of earthwork really is required, we were able to make a guesstimate. Okay, so you see, this is the reason why you need to have a field survey. You can very successfully bid or you can fail in that because of not knowing what is there. Okay, so in if you have any doubt in any of these points, or if you'd like to have any additional insight, you are welcome to ask. Because all these are an extension of what we did. If I talk, I'll be talking the same thing what I talked earlier. Okay? You're clear? See, whenever you sign a contract, it's between two parties. Okay? And there's always going to be a dispute. Okay, always something is not going to be acceptable to the buyer. Sometimes young engineers go they go and do everything by the book, and then you will find that, you know, that it winds up in a dispute. Okay, sometimes the person might not have known, and then also it can end up in a dispute. Okay, so these are two very big major dispute resolution mechanisms which we try to have. Okay, you always will know that there is going to be a dispute, there's no doubt about that. Only thing is, what we are going to do to solve the dispute is going to be important. If you go to a court, if you go to a court of law, today the number of cases which are pending are so many. By the time you get a judgment, it is 20 years. Many times, many of the people who are involved in the dispute die, because that's how the Indian system is there. So what is the trend now is, we go for arbitration. Okay, arbitration is done by a third party, a neutral party, who is respected by both the companies, both the partners, both the, not the partners, both the players. Both, when I say both the players, it's the client and the contractor. Both of them agree, and it is a tripartite discussion. Three parties are involved: the arbitrator, the client, and the contractor. The basis of the dispute resolution is the NIT document. Okay, when you make the bid, what is the only information which is given to you? It is nothing but the NIT document. So that document, the annexures, what are the document which talks about deletions, the minutes of meetings, and all other documented communications form the basis of the dispute resolution mechanism. So there you will go and say, sir, I thought that you wanted only gold plating. Today you are coming and asking me for gold. Not possible. So all that is done by an independent third party. Okay, this is called arbitration. Sometimes you go for mediation. Mediation is done by a party who's known between for both. They both go and try to settle a, make a peace deal between the parties. So typically in a big contracting firm, you may not go much for mediation. You'll mostly be going for arbitration. Arbitration is recognized by the courts. Arbitrations are recognized by courts. The reason is, instead of going to court, you can finish off the entire work outside the court. You don't need to have a lawyer. You don't have to prepare costly documentation and records. Both of us sit. Okay, instead of gold plating, you are saying gold bricks. The cost is going to increase by so much. And this is what you'll do. So things like this you will talk out and sort out. Sometimes arbitration is also come because of, you know, payment not being released. Many times people will not release payment in time, and many contracting firms will fall into hard times. If you are not paying your vendors in time, you lose the credit rating. Most of the work in our country run by credit. So if you are going to construct a very huge building, you need 1,000 cement bags. For 1,000 cement bags today, you will not have the money. So you usually get it against what is known as a credit note. Have you heard of the credit note? So what is a credit note? I believe you will give. So we will give you these bags on credit, but make sure you pay before such and such date. Suppose you keep getting two or three times on credit without paying, what happens? You lose your credit rating. People don't believe you. They say, sorry boss, I cannot give you the material. Please pay all the old dues. Okay. So this is, what happens, why did we give this example? Now, because the contractor has lost his credit rating, is not able to get materials for this project or for some of the other projects which he has taken up. So that means he's going to get into a big loss because nobody is going to pay him. So this sort of thing can also be taken up on an arbitration basis. Okay. So this is done by a neutral third party where all the parties involved are happy. Okay. See, for instance, for ICS, the chief guest, Mr. Andrew Samuel, he is a well-known arbitrator. All the people know that he is a very fair person in terms of arbitration. He gave a very good example when I was interacting with him some time ago. So there was a problem. Inside, fine aggregate has been unloaded and part has been started to be used. The client says, stop the work. Reason is, contract document says reverse sand. Now, we don't know whether he's using manufactured sand, reverse sand or sea sand. Okay, so the client is accusing this man of using the sea sand. So they come to an arbitrator, in this case Mr. Anbu Samuel, and say, sir, please help us sort our dispute. Okay, so he did it in a very interesting way. I'll leave it for a little later. Probably at the end of the day end of this class we'll have that. So if you go for mediation, these are some of the benefits. People need not even know that there is a fight. Okay, Rauni and I are fighting over something inside my cabin. Nobody knows. Everybody think Rauni and I are very good friends. Okay, Sai and I are going shouting at each other in the corridor. Inside the thing, I should not have talked like that to you. Yeah. Then I let him have some jolly good time. We both are having something. Okay, both things happened, no? So, suppose you are having it in the corridor, people start to talk. Sai wants some benefit from John. Okay. So, on the other hand, if suppose we are having a fight and both of us are big names, all the others who know that we are having a fight are not going to believe and give us another job. They think Rauni and John are going to split. Then Rauni and John's corporation is going to collapse. So, let us not give a job to them. So, you see, many times, dispute resolution, when it is done in private, it is good for the organization. See, some time ago, Monsanto and I think Bayer. Okay, this is a very big drug company, and another is a research in seed, something like that. So why should then suddenly, you know, they had some discussion of takeover. Suddenly they broke out. So when it breaks out, now what happens? People start to get worried. What is going to happen to the stocks of both of these companies? Okay, so many times if you are having a confidential dispute resolution, it is very, very good. Okay, but it does happen many times. You know, families have property disputes. What happens? The old person in the house, he comes in. That is what we call as mediation. Brothers don't fight. Okay, now arbitration is something like this monkey and cat story. If you go there, it may so happen that the monkey gets the entire cake. I reused the slide 3 times, but this is having a lot of fruit. Okay. So, these are the arbitration agencies. Tribunal, 3 members form. Who are the tribunal? Who form the tribunal? The neutral party, the 2 aggrieved parties, client and contractor in our case. If it is an international contractor, these are some of the international agencies which are recognized for arbitration. Okay. See, the arbitration can be done by an individual, provided both the parties accept that person as neutral. Okay. Arbitration can be done by any of these agencies, provided both the parties are confident that this person will not be influenced. See, many times, this is one of the practical things which we do. Rauni can't bribe John, but Rauni will take me to a 7-star hotel, give me good dinner, then he'll give me a small present. Okay, it will not be money, it will not be anything. Okay, this is something which happens always. Okay, I'll tell you my experience in one of these things. See, when that survey was done in that jungle area, the person told, sir, we are having a drinks party, come over. Whenever I come, I give my team this one. It's a very common thing in the construction world. Okay, so please don't mistake me if I tell this. Okay, and if you feel that, you know, this doesn't happen in the world, I must say, I'm sorry, boss. VAT has given you a little more sheltered life than what it is. Of course, I'm not attesting to any of this. Okay, so I didn't go. Next day, what happened was, he came with some drawings, which I had to sign, that he had done the work. I am attesting his work, that he has done work. Okay, if I attest it, L&T has to pay. Now, on that day, instead of me going to his office, I called him to my office, I ordered tea. It was a very good hotel, okay? My bill itself, I was not sure whether the company will pay. And I was ordering coffee very coolly. Coffee to about 8 people. Fortunately, we had credit cards, so everything was swiped. So now, what happened was, I was in a position to command. You won't believe. The day before had I joined those people, what would have happened? I don't know. I wouldn't have had a moral standing to say no. Today, when they came, they were all standing. I was sitting like the boss. And I'm sharing this experience with you because, you know, this is something which you are going to face in your life. You should know how to give. Same thing. If I had to do that favor to that man, hook or crook, I'd have made him have that. So this is where, you know, civil engineers have to develop their communication skills. And as a project manager or as in a project team, I feel that, you know, you are expected to do that. Let's come back here. When you look at an arbitrator, suppose you know that an arbitrator can be influenced by taking him to a hotel or something. Will you trust him? This is what we mean by this entire discussion on trust. Okay? So a tribunal has to be known to be very fair, very neutral. And Mr. Anbu Samuel, if he feels something wrong, he'll say, get out of my office. He'll just kick you out. No, there's no, like, you know, nice way, no sugar coating, nothing. Get lost. Go to hell. These are the terms he's going to use. Okay? So when you are so fair, you can be part of a tribunal. Okay? So this is the process of an arbitration. This plaint is nothing but complaint. Okay, so there's a scrutiny, registration, all the blah blah blahs. Any of these terms we feel is not known to you. It's just a flowchart. This flowchart will be available to you. Now, because FFCS is not working, I mean, I think you are not able to get a course page. I am also not getting course page. I will be uploading these slides on Moodle. Okay. So, then you've got two kinds of arbitration, ad hoc and institutional. So, it's very flexible. You can choose so many things. Okay, you can choose the person you want to have do the arbitration. Everything is yours. Okay, you can use, say for example, Maharashtra law or Tamil Nadu law or whatever law for interpreting your contract. Or you can use Indian law, Italian law, French law, whatever is convenient to you. Institutional arbitration might not be so flexible. See, you can take a holiday in Hawaii and say, we are going to do the arbitration there. Believe me, if you take your agreed party to Goa, matter is solved in your favor. Okay. This is from experience I am telling. Okay. You can really do a lot of, you can do wonders as a contractor if you are able to do all these things. Please believe me, nothing of this is illegal. It is not at all illegal. You are only helping the other person see your viewpoint more clearly. Okay. So, these are the benefits of arbitration or litigation. When you go for litigation, you take that person to court. You have to make him wait for a judge. Only, you know, like when the judge is having a slot, he can call you. I will call Rauni. Rauni will say, no. Today my son's university VIT is giving forms. I have to admit him there. I cannot come. Next day I will say something. I will not go. Okay. So this sort of things makes a litigation very long drawn. Instead of that, take the entire family to Goa or Hawaii, problem is solved. Okay, so that's why this arbitration and all these things are very effective. And for the love of heaven, please don't write, I will take my family to Hawaii and solve a problem in your answer paper. I will not accept it. This is just to help you understand. I want you guys to read up on arbitration. I want you to understand what this mediation is, because there is so much of resource available, a lot of resources available online, and I want you to read it up. Okay. So I am not going to definitely accept a babyish paper if you are going to hand it to me. Okay. So these are the usual arbitrators. Okay. So these are the people who usually do the arbitration. And So external experts, like I was telling, Mr. Anbu Samuel, he is an external expert. Okay. So with this, I'll close this lecture. I have stopped it well before 5:40. Of course, the reason is mainly I didn't go through the photographs which I had. I didn't give you any of the learnings. I was very selfish. I ran through it. Okay. So because of that, that is the truth why I managed to finish it by this time. So from today's class, what you would have learnt is you have a tendering process. The tendering process is very important because that forms the basis for further dispute resolution mechanism. Okay, please remember, husband and wife quarrel. I and my wife also quarrel. Okay, I am not an exception. Okay, we are having a very binding contract. No, marriage is a very binding contract. In that itself, problem comes. And what is this contract? Okay, so it means that chances that when you go to a construction site, you may be in the middle of a dispute. Okay, so how are you going to ensure, as a fresh engineer, you are not in the heart of the fire, in the middle of the fire? It is very simple. Please try to get your contract documents. Read it. Contract documents are typically around 100 pages. It tells everything end to end. What you should do, what you should not do. You can do something if they have not told you do it, or they have not explicitly told don't do it, you are welcome to do it. Okay, if they say don't open the gate and go, but you jump inside, you can say, sir, I jumped in, I didn't touch the gate, and somehow try to escape. Okay, so I know there are many ways by which you can bypass the things which are told. Okay, so until you are caught, there is no problem. But when you are caught, that's where everything happens. Okay, so the best way to be successful as a contractor is understand the contractor. You are not a site engineer when you join a company. When you join a company, you are still a contractor. Okay, maybe you are not one of those contractors who come in a big bullet, put a the dhoti and come. You are much better than them. You wear a shirt and pant, and you are having a white collar, literally, or a blue collar as we call it. So, but still you are a contractor at heart. You should understand how you are going to make money. Okay, contracts are done only to make money. So how all you can do, what all you can do, legally, ethically, please do it to make money. Hey, look here. I am not here doing social service. Okay. I am here as a lecturer. My job is to train you guys, and I am having selfish motives. I am getting paid. I am not doing social service here. Okay. Every one of us are going to do that. We are expected to do that. Okay. So, all the best. And this is the reason why we are going into all of these things. So you understand this. I wanted to be a successful engineer. So there should not be any issue or no litigation or arbitration in your construction site. It should not be that because John did that mistake, this company is in trouble. Put your name there. Okay. So we'll close the session now. I hope you found this session useful.